accurate?
The abrasion part of it is accurate, but as I told you, the injury number 7 also has a contusion underlying it.
How about diagramming? Before we mark in any fashion this collective description, has injury number, I think we're up to number 6?
Number 7, no.
Number 7, has that been diagrammed?
Yes, it is. As you can see it here.
And you've got number 7 and what subsequent ones, Doctor?
I have 8 and 9 after that, and I've already shown them on the G25, distal to number 7.
And does Dr. Golden diagram those injuries in the same schematic?
He has diagrammed one single marking on the finger corresponding to 8 and 9.
Has he written anything concerning any of that area?
He has indicated that there is areas of abraded, red abrasion in the back area there.
Doctor, would it be accurate if I were to circle this entire area to then describe what you are describing as injuries numbers 7, 8, and 9?
Yes, actually, all this would also include that because he says multiple red-brown abrasions, and he says quarter inch by 3/8 inch. That's a maximum dimension he gives it, reddish-brown, and all this would be included.
And Doctor, what, if anything, does this refer to?
He says that this would be the 3 knuckles of the index finger. He calls them, each of them, a knuckle, the interphalangeal joints.
And I cannot make out in you the words that appear above the word knuckle that you were just pointing to?
I am not able to read that.
Keep your voice up, please.
I think it refers to irregular here and configuration, C-O-N-F.
So now, Doctor, before I draw, I want to be sure I'm accurate. Would all of this information refer then to what you've described as injuries 7, 8, and 9?
Yes.
All right, for the record then, Your Honor, I will do that with the blue pen. And in the upper left quadrant, diagram 23-1, I'll write G-26, 25, INJs number 7, 8, and 9, Doctor?
Yes.
And in the protocol itself, Doctor, this first paragraph refers to what you have described as injuries 6, 7, 8, and 9?
Yes, paragraph 1.
And I'll outline that in red. And out at the side, G-26, 25, INJs, number 6, 7, 8, and 9, with an arrow touching the box. Anything further regarding these injuries, Doctor?
No, I already addressed that. 6 and 7 are also have a contusion underlying them.
And again, Dr. Golden's diagram does not include that description?
That's correct.
Nor does his protocol?
Yes.
Mistakes on your in your judgment on his part?
Yes.
Any significance?
No significance to the big picture items.
Is it significant, however, as to sources for those blunt force trauma injuries?
Yes, because if it's just an abrasion, you just have a scrape against the rough surface. But if it's an abrasion, contusion, it would be an impact of the hand against that surface, which has a different connotation as to the mechanism of injury.
And when you say an impact, Doctor, would that be, in your opinion, consistent with a hand that is moving with force in a backward direction by Mr. Goldman coming in contact with a rough surface like the tree and backing away from the assailant?
Yes.
Anything further about injury 6, 7, 8, or 9?
No.
Is there any additional injury in either photograph, G-26 or G-25?
There is, I would describe one more injury in G-26. There's a small abrasion above the abrasion contusion to be described here, and this is a 5/16 inch by 5/8 inch contusion. Abrasion.
Doctor, is it seen in photograph G25 as well?
Yes, you see it better here.
And for the record, on G26, it appears that the area of the injury that is closest to the hand is in contact or covered, if you will, by a margin of the photographic identification card.
Yes.
All right, Doctor, now this is an abrasion in your opinion?
Yes.
Do you have an opinion as to the source or sources?
It's a nonspecific blunt force scraping injury to the back of the forearm.
Is it one that, in your opinion, is antemortem before death?
Yes.
And is it diagrammed in any way by Dr. Golden?
Yes, it's diagrammed as in 21-1.
And I think Mr. Lynch has that. It's board 3G, Your Honor.
It could possibly be reflected by this abrasion injury here, but it's difficult to decide whether he really...
Keep your voice up, please, Doctor.
This diagrammatic marking here could represent that. I'm not sure whether that's what it was representing.
What, if any, writing is associated with that?
It just says abrasion here.
Is there a description given by dimension or any other information?
I can't read. It says 3/4 inch by 1/2 inch, and I think that refers to more the triangular abrasion above it, not to that marking.
And there also appears to be some writing down below where the schematic of the left hand ends. Does that refer at all to that same area?
No.
So, Doctor, if you'll point carefully to the area which possibly refers to this injury.
Possibly. I'm not sure this one.
All right. Let me circle that in red. I'll write out at the side, G-2625, INJ, number 10, is it, Doctor?
Yeah, possible.
And I'll put a big question mark.
Yeah.
Anything in the way of a description in the protocol?
It's on page 12, number 2. All the injuries to the left forearm have been described, including the triangular one, which we just discussed, and there's no specific mention of this particular one, but this paragraph would include all the injuries in the forearm.
Doctor, if you could look to the photograph to the left, G26, and I can't see the number at the moment.
G21.
G21. Do you see this triangular shape injury?
Yes, here you can see it here.
And that is what kind of injury, Doctor?
That's again a non-specific blunt force injury, which could have been caused by the environment which is present in the Bundy drive.
What kind of blunt force trauma injury is it?
Again, this could be a branch. You know, as I told you, there are branches which have been cut and there are stalks there. And when you have the forearm rubbing against one of those stalky branches or the stalks of the branch, you could have this kind of abrasion.
It is an abrasion?
Yes.
All right. And you've already pointed out, apparently it was diagrammed by Dr. Golden?
Yes.
Is there any description given with the diagram itself?
Here, triangular 3/4 inch by 1/2 inch abrasion.
Doctor, and what number, if any, do you give to that injury in G21?
In G21, I gave it a number 2.
All right, let me circle this area in blue.
And this measurement also corresponds to the same.
Which measurement, Doctor?
That's 3/4 inch by 1/2 inch. It's given the measurement twice. This.
All right, let me try and include that as well. Does this ABR refer to anything, Doctor?
Yes, it's abrasion.
Referring to that same triangular area?
Yes.
I'll include that then in the circled area on form 21-1, and I'll write at the side, G-21, and I'm sorry, Doctor, injury number 1? The triangular shape. Injury is which number, according to your argument?
Injury number 2 in G21.
I'm sorry. Injury number 2. I'll write that in.
Yeah.
All right. Let's finish. What other blunt force trauma injuries are included collectively by Dr. Golden in this paragraph, item 2 of page 12? If you could go to the photographs and show us.
He has also addressed this linear abrasion above the triangular abrasion of the left forearm in G21, and that is also diagrammed here. And he has addressed it in the protocol here as a 3/4 inch in length abrasion.
What injury number have you arbitrarily assigned that
one? I assigned that as injury number 3.
Of G21?
Yes.
Let me outline that first on the protocol in blue, and I'll write G-21. INJ number 3,
And I also have, you have to address this 3/4 inch by 1/2 inch triangular abrasion, which is injury number 2 of G21.
All right, I'll do that in red then. On the protocol, same page. And that's going to be G-21 INJ number 2. Is that correct, Doctor?
Yes.
All right, and then over here where you pointed out before I circle, Doctor, is this the area that refers to that injury number 3?
Yes. Yes, this particular abrasion. But my concern is whether the measurement here, he says 3/4 inch by 1/2 inch, and again says 3/4 inch by 1/2 inch, whether one of the 3/4 inch applies to this measurement.
Does he describe injury number 3 then as 3/4 inch by 1/2 inch?
No, he just says 3/4 inch. So I'll just diagram the number 2 there next to it.
All right, let me circle this area in red on the outline, the schematic. I'll write G-21 INJ. This is number 3?
Yes.
Doctor, would you consider these mistakes in the sense that
he has described them fairly accurately, the triangular abrasion and the linear abrasion, so they are not mistakes per se.
Is a fairly accurate description a satisfactory description in your judgment, Doctor?
Well, it's the triangular abrasion has been described properly and the linear abrasion has been described.
But not completely?
That's correct, because you have another abrasion there which has not been addressed, but he says that there are multiple abrasions in the forearm. He has not addressed them individually.
And is his failure to do that considered by you a mistake?
Yes.
Any significance?
No.
Same reason?
Yes.
What's next in this collective group?
We have a smaller abrasion just below the blue card here.
On G21?
Yes. And you can also see it on G26 here.
At the top of that photograph?
Yes.
Have you given it an arbitrary number?
Number 1.
Of which photograph,
of
Doctor?
G21.
Of G21?
Yes.
All right, do you see it diagram?
Well, this is the same area which we had a question mark whether it was injury number 10 of G26. It could also represent injury number 1 of G21 because there's only one marking there for both those injuries.
All right, let me then add under the description previously given on the diagram board the word or G-21 INJ number 1 with a question mark.
And you can see both of them in context better in G26.
Is there relationship, as shown in that photograph G26, of significance to you in forming any opinion as to how they were incurred?
No, they are non-specific blunt force injury. I can't make any inference on that.
Anything further with respect to this collective group that's in this paragraph item 2 of page 12 of the protocol?
No.
So in order to complete this item, let me circle the number 2 and indicate collectively which injuries, Doctor?
1, 2, and 3 of G21.
G-21 INJ numbers 1, 2, and 3.
And could be an injury number 10 of G20.
And possibly?
Injury 10.
G26?
Yes.
INJ number 10?
Yes.
Is that accurate, Doctor?
Yes.
Anything further?
No.
Are we done with G26?
Yes.
Are we done with G21?
Yes.
So we are left with G20 and G23?
Yes.
We talked yesterday briefly about G20, Doctor, and you talked about this interrupted abrasion. Do you recall that?
Yes, and also I described the abrasion in detail, the different parts of it.
All right. Is, first of all, that diagrammed in any fashion by Dr. Golden?
No.
Is it addressed anywhere in the protocol?
No.
Is it discussed at all in the addendum?
No.
All mistakes?
Yes.
Any significance to you?
No.
Same reasons?
Yes.
Is there any other injury you identify in G20?
There's also a smaller abrasion just above in the region of the elbow area, and I've already discussed this complex interrupted abrasion in the left arm and the smaller abrasion above it. And
The interrupted abrasion you talked yesterday about the clothing getting folded as one basis that you end up with this situation?
Yes.
Now, what about this abrasion that you describe as being below the photographic card in G20?
Yeah, I gave it a number also. It's again a non-specific abrasion.
Is that diagram?
No.
Is it addressed in the protocol?
No.
Addressed in the addendum?
No.
Same answers to the mistake questions?
Yes.
Including significance or lack of significance?
Yes.
Any other injury in G20?
No.
Just to conform to the wound chart, which is our exhibit 351, of G20, which is injury number one?
The lowest one is injury number one.
What is injury number two?
Injury number two is this, the three portions to the left arm area, an abrasion which has three portions to it. And then injury number three is the topmost one.
Okay. And the topmost one is where, doctor?
It's right here. You can see it.
And what is that injury number three?
That's also an abrasion, which is 3/4 inch by 1/8 inch in size.
Is that discussed at all in the protocol?
No.
Diagrammed anywhere?
No.
Addressed in the addendum?
No.
All mistakes?
Yes.
Same answers?
Yes.
Any other injuries in G20?
No.
Are we done with that photograph?
Yes, we have.
Let's go to G23.
Yes. G23 shows the left forearm and shows the inner aspect of the left forearm and also shows the left nipple area. So I have described two injuries. The other injuries seen in this photograph have already been addressed. You have the abrasion behind the left distal forearm, which was injury number 10 of G26. We have the smaller abrasion here, which is injury number one, I think. Or, yeah, injury number one of G21. Yes, injury number one of G21. So barring that, we have an abrasion on the ulnar aspect of the left wrist, and you have this abrasion near the left nipple.
Doctor, I want to be clear in my own mind. You're saying that that is the nipple of the left breast?
Oh, the right breast.
So that's the right breast?
Yes, but the abrasion is in the left forearm wrist area.
And injury number one for G23 is that area of the left wrist?
Yes.
Is that described at all in the protocol?
Yes, it is.
Where?
Page 13, number 5.
Is that an accurate description of what you see in photograph G23?
No, it is not.
In what way is it inaccurate?
He described it as two bruises in his protocol description, but it's not a bruise. It's more, and he says it's not abraded. You can clearly see it's an abraded injury with the peeling of the skin.
How can you see that it is clearly abraded, and Dr. Golden, on the other hand, describes it as fresh bruises?
I can only say what I see here. This is peeling of the skin, which is a flap of skin like any other abrasion, like we saw on the little finger here, that the skin flap has been peeled off, and you can see the peeling of the skin right here. And the injury itself is an abrasion injury.
Doctor, would you say that normally it is better to see the actual wound on the body than to review it photographically?
That is correct.
Sustain, refer to the question.
Doctor, in your experience, do you find that a review of injuries on the body yields a more accurate identification than one drawn from photographic identification?
Looking at the body definitely helps because you have a three-dimensional look at the injury. And also you can make incisions to see the depth of the bruising and other the ability to do other examinations to better define the injury. But in a photograph, you can clearly interpret what the injury appears to be, whether it's an abrasion or contusion, without difficulty. But you may not be able to tell how deep the bruise is because you can't cut. It's only a two-dimensional view. It's not a three-dimensional view, and you don't have that additional ability to study the injury in more detail.
Doctor, I believe
you actually motion to strike non-response.
Overall.
Doctor, I believe you testified several days ago that you routinely review cases performed by other medical examiners informing independent opinions to testify where those individuals, for example, have left your office or are on vacation. Is that correct?
Yes.
And that's the same process also available for Dr. Wolf or Dr. Bodden. That is, they weren't there to examine the bodies either. Is that correct?
Objection calls for speculation.
I think we've already asked this question before.
Doctor, is this diagram, this injury number one diagram?
Yes, it is.
Where is the diagram?
23-1. Right here.
Where you point it appears to have a lot of blackened area.
Yes.
What leads you to believe that there is an entry there that concerns injury number one of G23?
It's two discolored areas on the, two markings on the diagram on the same area where the injury is present. And there is some notations here which also have been darkened, but the measurements here have been dictated here in the body of the autopsy report.
And when you say the measurements here, you're referring to where?
You can see this to be 3/8 inch by 3/8 inch and then 1/2 inch by 1/2 inch.
Even though it's darkened?
Yes.
And you see that same description provided in this page 13, item 5 entry?
Yes.
From just looking at the diagram, Doctor, and your experience in the office and its customs and practices and those of Dr. Golden, can you offer any explanation as to why this area is darkened?
Well, I one explanation would be that he diagonalized the injury and then he maybe went back and didn't want it mentioned or didn't think it was the right area. Then he went back and thought it was the same area. I just have to give my feeling on what happened. I can't tell really what happened.
All right.
But the point is, it is as it is on the diagram, and the description is as it is on the protocol.
Doctor, is it accurate if I circle this entire area? And I don't know, is this area to refer, in your opinion, to that injury?
It would reflect the same area because it says skin, and and says dermis there.
And is that, in your opinion, something that is a consideration in describing that injury number one of G23?
Yes.
Let me circle this information in red in the lower left quadrant, and I'll write G-23 INJ number one. And I'll write, or I'll outline on the protocol this item number five, and write G-23 INJ number one. And I'll write, Doctor, in your opinion, this injury is an abrasion, not a contusion?
Well, it's an abrasion as far as the skin surface goes, and it looks like an abrasion and not an abrasion contusion.
All right, and I'll write, per Dr. L, abrasion, not contusion. Is that accurate, Doctor?
Yes.
Anything further about injury number one?
No.
Is there any other injury of G23 which you identify from that photograph that we have not discussed?
To the right nipple, you have a abrasion contusion here.
Doctor, is that discussed in the protocol?
No.
Diagram?
No.
Addressed in the addendum?
No.
Do you have an opinion as to the circumstance under which that abrasion contusion was?
It's again a nonspecific blunt force injury to the right nipple area.
And would your answers about that be the same as they have been concerning all other contusion abrasions seen in the hand photographs?
Yes.
The mistakes, I assume they are mistakes to not address it, diagram it, or address it in the addendum. Is that correct?
Yes.
Of any significance individually or collectively?
No.
Anything else about G23?
No.
Are we done with this photograph board?
Yes.
Your Honor, I have another board of photographs. May they be marked as Exhibit 362?
People's 362.
sharp force injuries to left flank, left thigh, and right chest of Mr. Goldman, blunt force trauma, and lividity. Again, doctor, with the court's permission, if you'll step down, I'm sorry. Mr. Lynch, point something out to me, and I do want to cover. We left out in our earlier discussion photograph G55 and the facial area. And G55, doctor, is
yes.
The photograph in the lower area, second from the right border.
Yes.
How many injuries have you identified to the right side of Mr. Goldman's face that we have not discussed already?
I have five areas of injury which has not been discussed so far.
Would you just take us through slowly, in general terms, these areas?
Yeah. You have two types of injury to the right side of the face. You have blunt force injuries, and you have sharp force injuries. The blunt force injuries are represented here as scrapes. I'll go over the numbering after I've given my initial description. You have a linear abrasion here. You have a curved abrasion there. You have an area of confluent abrasions in the right cheek. The linear abrasion and the curved abrasion are to the right forehead, right temple area. Then there are also abrasions present around the right eye. So these are all the blunt force injuries.
Doctor, what did you mean by confluent abrasion?
Confluence means they are there are linear abrasions which are merging with each other in this area of the cheek.
All right.
And then, in addition, overlying some of these abrasions in the right cheek area, you have evidence of five sharp force injuries, cuts. You have one, two, three, four, and five cuts to the surface of the skin, which are sharp force injuries, and four of them seem to overlie the abrasion injury to the cheek, which would indicate that these abrasion injuries occurred before these sharp force injuries to the right cheek area. You also have this the fifth sharp force injury, which is not in the area of the abrasion injury, wherein you cannot opine whether it happened before or after. So that roughly describes all the injuries you see in the right side of the face. As I have done with the other injuries, I have numbered them for my convenience, and we will go over them if you want to.
In just a moment, I want to ask just a couple of follow-up questions. The five sharp force injuries that you described as cuts, four of which you identify as appearing to overlie the area of the abrasions, is that correct?
Yes.
In your opinion, what would be a source or sources for those cuts?
A knife.
And from the nature of your observation of those wounds, do you have an opinion as to whether they are all consistent with a single-edged knife with a maximum blade length of approximately 6 inches tapering at the end, as you've described?
They could have been caused by that.
But from the nature of the form of each of those cuts on the surface of the face, can you exclude a double-edged knife as a source for each of them?
I cannot.
Now, doctor, hypothetically, let me ask a couple of preliminary questions, then I'll ask a hypothetical. From your examination of that area, do you have an opinion as to whether one or more of those five sharp force injuries was received before death?
They were all received before death.
How are you able to determine that those five sharp force injuries were received before death?
The description in the report indicates that there is a hemorrhage in the tissue.
From your observation of the photographs, are you able to confirm from just that observation, that these five sharp force injuries are inflicted before death?
The appearance supports that opinion, because they are no different from the other antemortem injuries which are present.
Now, the underlying abrasions to the four of the five sharp force injuries, are they antemortem, that is, inflicted before death?
Yes, they are.
How are you able to make that determination?
The same reasons, the appearance, the reddish-brown color, and as I outlined before.
Now, hypothetically, Doctor, if Mr. Goldman had been disabled from by his assailant's attack, but still had a beating heart, and the assailant wanted to check to see whether Mr. Goldman was still alive or not, and took this knife, and while Mr. Goldman was in a position where the right side of his face was exposed, poked the knife in the area shown in G55 to basically detect any reaction from Mr. Goldman, would that set of circumstances be consistent with what you see anatomically in this photograph, G55?
Yeah.
Sustained.
Doctor, from the nature of the observations of these five sharp force injuries, which you describe as all being antemortem, and from the underlying abrasions, which you describe as being antemortem, is there anything inconsistent from what you see with a hypothetical set of circumstances of the assailant in an effort to ascertain whether Mr. Goldman is alive, poking his face five separate times with the end of the knife?
Objection, suspect.
Sustained.
Your Honor, may I be heard on that, please?
No.
Doctor, medically, is there anything from what you see in the photograph which permits you to understand or offer an opinion as to the sequence from the standpoint of a scenario, separate and apart from the cuts overlying the abrasions, to describe how those cuts were inflicted?
Yes. Let's take the one which we have in the right cheek lower part, which is not in an area of abrasion. It's a superficial puncture type sharp force injury. That could occur at the same time, since they all have hemorrhage and they all occurred when Mr. Goldman had some blood pressure. It could occur at the same time when the threatening cuts took place as a threatening puncture. That particular puncture could have taken place at that time. Now, regarding the other punctures, they're all superficial punctures. And I have no way of knowing exactly why they were done, because they really don't have any fatal injury per se from them. They are only superficial punctures. And I would favor that it could be after the fatal injuries were inflicted, it could be it could have been inflicted to check whether he was still alive or not. That would be one conclusion I would draw also.
Now, Doctor, you started to say arbitrarily how you have numbered these particular injuries. Let's start with your injury number one and go through them, please.
Injury number one is the linear abrasion, which extends from the right forehead down to the right cheek area. Injury number two is the...
Before you move from injury one to injury two, have you measured that injury?
Yes, I measured it as 2.5 inches in length.
Is there any significance in your judgment from its length and appearance on the question of identifying any source or sources for causing it?
This would again be an abrasion which could be caused by a cut branch or a stalk which could rub against the face in this manner.
Let me, if I could, just ask counsel to move slightly aside and get a photograph for me. And Mr. Lynch, could you move? Exhibit
359. Doctor, would you point out again on these photographs of the scene at the Bundy, the kind of environmental source or sources, in your opinion, which could have caused this injury number one, this linear abrasion?
The face was obviously dragged on a rough surface, or the rough surface was dragged on the facial area. What I'm trying to point out is, if you look at crime scene number two, and also in crime scene number three, and crime scene S6, you see areas of where there are cut stalks of or stumps of a plant, and you have similar cut stumps also available on the branch of the tree here, and stalks such as that can cause abrasions such as this.
In what manner, Doctor?
Your Honor, there'll be a motion to strike. Yes, photographs were taken in 1995.
Sustained. Answers. Last answer is stricken. Jury to disregard.
Doctor, I want you to assume that the photographs taken in 1995 fairly and accurately depict the stumps and show these. Use the same word you used, shoots, if you will, that have grown somewhat but are basically in the same general condition except for their length as they were on June 12th and 13th of 1994.
Be an objection, no foundation.
There will be a foundation laid by another witness later in this trial, Your Honor.
All right, subject to motion to strike. Proceed.
Now, given that hypothetical set of circumstances, Doctor, would you please then explain how these particular kinds of shoots can create an injury like that 2+ inch laceration. I'm sorry, abrasion, linear abrasion.
The same mechanism I mentioned earlier, when you have a cut branch rubbing against your skin surface, it can cause a linear cut abrasion.
Doctor, as long as I'm holding the board, why don't you take us through injury number two, if it relates also to this environmental scene.
Injury number two is the curved abrasion here in the upper part of this linear abrasion here and the right forehead area.
In your opinion, is injury number two a distinct injury from injury number one?
Yes, it's separate from injury number one, both though they both meet at a particular area.
And any source or sources from the environmental photographs provided here in 359, which would be a source for that kind of injury, injury number two?
Same type of similar source, a branch or a cut stalk of a stump of a branch.
Branch of a stump, maybe?
Well, a branch which is not complete.
Okay. The stump, as you use the term stump, refers to which of the areas?
No, what I'm saying is I just gave the stumps on the ground level here on crime scene number three. You have similar stumps also on the branch of the tree there.
All right. Now, Doctor, how about injury number three, if it pertains to a source or sources from the environment as shown in these photos?
Injury number three is this confluent area of abrasions in the right cheek area.
And in your opinion, are those confluent abrasions consistent with a source or sources from sources seen in the photographs?
This similar source, as you can see on the crime scene area. The tree is not well seen here. I see it only in the S photographs.
Well, why don't you point out in the S photographs what it is from the tree that can be a source for that confluent series of abrasions?
If you look at the other side of the tree and in the base of the tree area here, you have similar stumps like you see on the ground level here on CS3. And those branches can result in these kind of abrasions.
Are those confluent abrasions, abrasions which are actually individual injuries that just run together, or are they from one overall mechanism causing the total appearance?
I would favor overall mechanism causing a similar appearance, because you have several structures there which can cause the abrasion which you see here in the cheek.
How about injury number four?
Injury number four is the small linear abrasions around the right eye area here.
Doctor, again, any source or sources environmentally consistent with those?
Same sources which I just discussed.
And how about then injury number five, is it?
Injury number five is collectively, I described all the five sharp force injuries to the right cheek area, and I measured them individually in a counterclockwise direction, but I labeled them as injury number five.
Have we omitted any additional injuries to the face?
No.
And other than going through the protocol diagrams and so forth, have we covered a discussion of the facial injuries of G55?
Yes. So basically, you have a blunt force and a sharp force injury to the face.
Why don't we use the time we have to try and go through quite quickly the protocol and diagrams, if any, and the addendum, if any, concerning those. And we're going to get the diagram put on the other. Doctor, let's start with injury number one, that 2+ inch linear abrasion.
It's in diagram number, you want to start with the diagram or?
Sure.
Diagram number 22-3.
All right, if Mr. Lynch could turn to form three of that board. I forget the number of it, but we'll get it. 4G.
He diagrams the linear abrasion. Injury number one, the curved abrasion, the confluent abrasion here in the right cheek, and the abrasions around the right eye. The only thing is in the diagram for the linear abrasion of the right side of the face and the curved abrasion, he called them cuts, but they're abrasions.
All right. First of all, let's just identify them individually. Which reflects or concerns injury number one?
This particular line going down here.
And is there a description that goes along with that?
Basically, it says 1 3/4 inch in the protocol. You want to turn to the protocol?
All right, why don't you tell us which page to turn to?
Page 6, number 4. Describe them as multiple superficial incised wounds, and he described it as a 3-inch incised wound in the original protocol, in the right side of the face extending from the forehead to the cheek, and he also described other superficial wounds, 0.5 inch to 1 inch.
Doctor, in your opinion, these are not incised wounds or cuts?
No.
How are you able to make that determination?
Just the
graphically.
Just the appearance, you can tell they are abrasions. And also, if you look at under the magnifying glass, you can see the irregularity to the margins, which would be consistent with an abrasion rather than an incised wound.
In your opinion, is it a mistake for Dr. Golden to have opined that these are incised wounds?
Yes.
Any significance to you in any of the big ticket questions?
No.
Why not?
Because of the same reasons I've told before. They don't interfere with my ability to tell you the type of weapon or bleeding effect causing the death, etc.
And doctor, does this paragraph 4 cover more than just injury number 1 as you arbitrarily identified them?
It also reflects the other curved injury next to it, and he calls them cuts.
Is the same series of answers going to apply that you just gave to your opinion that these are this is an abrasion injury number one rather than an incised wound? Will that apply to the same questions if asked of you on this injury number two?
Yes.
Other than injury one and two, is there any additional injury addressed in this item four?
No.
All right, let me outline this area of the protocol in red, and I'll write G-55, INJ numbers one and two, but per Dr. L, abrasions, not cuts. Is that accurate, Doctor?
Yes.
And then, if you would please, again, on the diagram form, which is injury one and which is injury two?
This is one, and this is two.
All right, where you indicated one, I'll do it in blue. Is that correct?
Yes, yes, length 3-inch, IW incised wound, superficial.
And I'll write G-55, INJ, number one, and I'll write in quotes, abrasion. And then if you point out injury number two, please.
Injury number two is this code area here.
And is there any written description to go along with that?
It says cuts, various, superficial.
Let me circle that area again on the diagram in red this time. And I'll write out at the side G-55, INJ number two, and I'll also write abrasion in quotes. Is it diagrammed anywhere else, Doctor?
Mainly in 23, or mainly in this diagram.
Is there any aspect of the addendum which addresses either injury one or injury two?
Yes, it does. Page two, number three.
Page two, number three, Doctor?
Yes. He amended it to indicate that they were all abrasions, and he described that the area of abrasion is 4.5 inches by 2.5 inches, and he describes more clearly that one of the abrasions in the right frontal area is curvilinear.
Is that your injury number two?
Yes. And he also describes that the longest abrasion extends from the right temple to the cheek, 2.5 inches in length. And he also addresses injury number four of the right lower eyelid as a triangular appearing abrasion.
We'll get to that after lunch. But is it your opinion, Doctor, that this paragraph now accurately describes injuries one and two?
Yes.
And let me outline then that area, with the exception of the last sentence, which you've indicated, Doctor, goes to another injury of G-55, and I'll write outside G-55, INJ numbers 1 and 2. Is that accurate, Doctor?
Yes.
Your Honor, does the Court wish to break it?
Yes. Thank you, Counsel. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our noon recess. Please remember all of my admonitions to you. Don't discuss the case amongst yourselves, form any opinions about the case, conduct any deliberations till the matter has been submitted to you, or allow anybody to communicate with you with regard to the case. We'll stand in recess until 1:30. All right, Doctor? Thank you. Right, back on the record in the Simpson matter, all parties are again present. All right, Deputy Magnaro, let's have the jurors, please.
Your Honor?
Yes, Mr. Neufeld? I thought you were going to take that up informally with Mr. Clark.
What was left is we would take everything I wanted to report back to the court because there are some concerns about it, if I may.
Certainly. Mr. Neufeld, good afternoon, sir.
Thank you. Your Honor, it's been about 4 weeks since we made it very clear to the prosecution in this case that we objected to Dr. Ware using any likelihood ratios if and when he was called as a witness. At that time, 4 weeks ago, on May 15th and on May 16th, Mr. Clark indicated to the court that it wasn't his intention to use Dr. Weir for likelihood ratios, but rather for the underlying frequency data contained in that report. We needed to know which tack they were going to take, because as we made it clear to the court at that time, if they took the tack of pursuing likelihood ratios, then we would have a 402 hearing and we would need to contact witnesses. We had never heard anything more in the intervening 4 weeks as to which way they were going to go, until we got that report last week, which seemed to still indicate their pursuit of likelihood ratios. I spoke to Mr. Clark this morning at the suggestion of the court, and apparently, as he can report to Your Honor, they don't know yet, and they haven't been able to speak to Dr. Weir in the last few days or whatever because he's been on vacation. Our concern is that, and I think there's some fundamental unfairness here, and that the defense is certainly prejudiced by the situation, in that they've had more than enough time to find out which way they're going to move on this, so we can go out and, if need be, secure witnesses for such a hearing. All I'm asking is that, at this point in time, since they've now indicated that they intend to call Dr. Weir as early as next week, which doesn't give us a lot of time, that they inform the court on the record and inform counsel, certainly no later than, tomorrow's Wednesday, certainly no later than Thursday, as to whether or not they intend to pursue the route of likelihood ratio, so we can get ready in time for a hearing for next week. Otherwise, we won't be able to do it with enough time.
Mr. Clark?
Yes, Your Honor. Dr. Weir, he is on vacation and will be riding home or riding home tomorrow. He is to contact us as soon as he is able to. So it's our intent to speak with him tomorrow, maybe in the evening. And I indicated to Mr. Neufeld earlier today that once we've had that discussion with him, I think we'll be in a much better position to declare to him what types of evidence we may wish to offer in front of the jury. So I think at this point it's premature, but we're going to operate with all deliberate speed.
All right, then may I trust that this issue will be laid to rest at the latest by the close of business Friday?
I would hope so, yes. I might indicate to the court, Dr. Weir, in fairly quick fashion, produced a report, a preliminary report, as Mr. Neufeld indicated, very quickly. It's not totally complete, but he felt it important that both we and the defense have something to work from in this area. It's our intent to present, in terms of these population frequencies, what the scientific community feels is appropriate, and we will convey that direction that the community is telling us as soon as we're able to, after we speak with Dr. Weir.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, counsel. I look forward to hearing more DNA. All right. Let's have the jury, please.
Can I have just about 30 seconds?
Sure. All right, let the record reflect we've been rejoined by all the members of our jury panel. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Dr. Lakshmanan is again on the witness stand undergoing direct examination by Mr. Kelberg. And Mr. Kelberg, you may conclude your direct examination.
I'm going as quickly as I can, Your Honor.
All right.
Dr. Lakshmanan, again, with the court's permission, can you step down? Let's finish, if we can, please, going through the injuries that are in the photograph, G55. I believe we stopped, if I'm not mistaken, with the protocol and diagrams through injury number 2. Is that correct? The curvilinear?
That is correct.
And let's pick up, if we could, Doctor, would you identify what is injury number 3?
The injury number 3 is this confluent area of abrasions in the right cheek area, which I described in the morning right here.
Has Dr. Golden diagrammed that confluent area?
Yes, he has.
Where?
In diagram 22-3.
Would you indicate, please, Doctor, where it has been diagrammed and what, if any, description has been provided? If Mr. Lynch could perhaps move back this way.
This is the area of abrasion injury, which he has diagrammed here on the left lower quadrant of 22-3. And he has described the description here, 1.5 inch by 3/4 inch abrasion, reddish brown, belongs to this area here. And also this description here applies to this area of injury.
What is that description that you were just pointing to?
Patchy, circumscribed area of abrasions. Actually, it's not patchy, it's poorly defined.
Mr. Kelberg, I was wondering if you and Dr. Lakshmanan could stop talking over each other.
I'll try to do better.
Right. Thank you.
It says poorly defined circumscribed abrasions.
Doctor, if you'll keep your voice up too, it'll be helpful.
I don't know, Mr. Kelberg, would it be helpful to move the microphone to the doctor's tie? Would that be a better location for it?
I'm getting a shake of the head side to side from the sound person.
I'll talk louder, Your Honor.
You promise, Doctor?
Yeah.
No, but he's been talking a long time.
Try my best, Your
Honor. I know.
The right cheek area shows this poorly circumscribed area of abrasions, 1.5 inch by 3/4 inch. Poorly defined, rather.
Doctor, is this writing here at all to correspond at all to what you've described as injury number 3?
I don't know, this would be injury number 4, next to the eye.
So before I start marking with a permanent marker, would it be accurate to include this area?
No, not that area.
I'm sorry, not that area.
Just the same.
Would that otherwise be accurate?
Yes.
Circle that area in the lower left quadrant. And I'll write G-55, INJ, number 3. Does Dr. Golden then describe that confluent area, Doctor, in the protocol?
Right here, page 6, item 5, the first 5 lines.
Would you point to where that ends for that description?
Right here, above.
That on the protocol in red, and to the left I'll write G-55,
yes.
INJ number 3.
Yes.
Doctor, is that an accurate description, in your opinion, of this confluent area?
Yes. Yes.
Is this injury number 3 addressed at all in the addendum?
No.
In your judgment, was there any reason to do so?
No.
Is there anything further about injury number 3 which we have not discussed?
No.
Let's look at injury number 4 then, if you would identify it first from the photograph.
Injury number 4 includes these abrasions around the right eye, including a triangular area of abrasion.
From what you just told us a few moments ago, I gather there is some indication in 22 Roman numeral 3.
Yes, as you can see some of the abrasions diagram there. But also, that's only diagram where you see it, 22-3, right there.
Doctor, is there more than one line on the schematic
to represent injury number four?
There's one or two lines here.
How many individual abrasions do you include in your description of injury number four?
I just describe them as linear and irregular abrasions around the eye.
From looking at the photograph or any other photograph, can you approximate the total number of such abrasions around the eye?
About three of them there. Three of them there in all the photographs I have seen.
Let me outline this area then again in red. Is that the accurate area, Doctor? That
yes.
I just outlined? And I'll draw a line out to the right side and write G-55. INJ number four.
Anything further about this?
He correctly labels them as abrasions here, abrasions, ABR. But in the description, they've been included under that. He just called them various other superficial wounds in the description of an item four of page six. So it's not a, it reflects what he has diagrammed there.
So what you were just pointing to, Doctor, under item four, page six of the autopsy protocol, where we've already written in G-55 injuries one and two, but per Dr. L, abrasions, not cuts, that description includes, in your opinion, the description of injury number four?
Yes.
And although Dr. Golden has annotated the diagram to reflect multiple abrasions, he has in fact written a description that describes them as a superficial wound varying from 1/2 to 1 inch?
Yes.
Let me circle that area in blue just to set it off from what we've already outlined in red. Circle that on the protocol. I'll write out at the side G-55, INJ number four, but see diagram.
Okay.
22-3, and I'll write abrasions in quotation marks.
And he has addressed it to the addendum also.
He said there's something addressed in the addendum, Doctor?
Yes.
We have that here. Tell us where.
Page 2, number 3.
Doctor?
Yes.
Where?
The last line here. He has described that triangular abrasion which you see in the photograph as triangular. One adjacent to the right lower eyelid is triangular in appearance. Page 2, number 3, last line.
Would you point again on the photograph where that particular abrasion is?
It's right there. There are other photographs which show it well, but in that photograph which is in evidence, it shows it right here where I'm pointing it and below the right eye.
And that's on G-55, Your Honor, and appears to be the injury which is closest to the lower part of the right eye.
Yes.
And I'll outline this area also on the addendum in blue, circle it, and out at the side write G-55, INJ number 4. Anything further in the addendum regarding that injury, Doctor?
No.
All right, let's take the addendum down and ask you if you would please to move to injury number 5.
Injury number 5, I've collectively labeled as injury number 5 all the five sharp force injuries to the right cheek and area, and I measured them varying from 5/8 inch, 3/8 inch, 1/4 inch, 5/8 inch, and 1/4 inch respectively, and measured in a counterclockwise direction. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
And Doctor, is this the series four of which, in your opinion, overlay the confluent abrasions shown as injury number 3?
Yes.
Did Dr. Golden diagram any of those five superficial cuts?
Yes, in 22-1. Right here in the left lower quadrant, and he has labeled it also 5 superficial incised wounds of skin of right cheek. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Is that an accurate, first of all, diagrammatic representation of their location?
Yes.
Is it an accurate description of what you see in the photograph?
Yes, and it's also described in the report here.
Before we get to the report, there appears to be some writing to the right of the schematic. Does that associate itself with these 5 superficial cuts?
Yes. It says very superficial cuts here.
I'm sorry, what did you say?
Superficial about? Cuts. Superficial IW is incised wounds.
And that's a more formal way of referring to a cut?
Yes.
Let me circle this entire area then. And I'm going to ask you, Doctor, when I'm done doing that, if you could, after I to the side, I'm going to write G-55 INJ number 5.
Yes.
Would you point out very slowly, and I'll circle in red, the 5 cuts as diagrammed by Dr. Golden?
1, 2.
Let's stop at 1. And is there an entry for the size of that that's adjacent to it?
It says 1/2 inch there.
So this is number 1?
Yes.
I'll circle and I'll write number 1 of 5.
This is 2 here.
I'll circle that.
No, there's only 1 there. This is the 2, 3, and 4.
I'm sorry, which is?
This is number 2.
Which, Doctor?
This one, what I'm pointing out right there.
All right. Let me shorten that circle, and I'll cover what I shouldn't have in a second. Out of the side, I'll write number 2 of 5. Where's 3?
Right next to it there.
What? I'm sorry, down here?
Right there.
What is already circled in red?
Yes.
All right. Let me keep that then, and I'll just write up here, number 3 of 5.
This is number 4.
I'm sorry, here, Doctor?
This one right here, pointing out right there.
All right, let me circle that, and I'll out of the side write number 4 of 5.
And this is number 5 here.
And is there some writing associated with that?
It says, I think it's 5/8 of an inch.
Doctor, which is the one of these 5 that, in your opinion, does not overlay the area of the confluent abrasion?
Right, this one.
That's what we've labeled number 5 of 5?
Yes.
Now, you said Dr. Golden addressed this as well in the protocol?
Yes, he addresses it as page 6, item 2. This whole paragraph refers to that.
Is that an accurate description of what you see in the photograph G-55 concerning this injury or series of injuries?
Yes.
Let me outline this in blue. And I'll write G-55 INJ number 5. Doctor, in Dr. Golden's description, the last sentence, he says they are superficial, these 5 wounds involving the skin only associated with a small amount of cutaneous hemorrhage. Doctor, is that information of assistance to you in assessing whether those 5 cuts were inflicted before death, at or around the time of death, or after death?
It would, to me, it would indicate that they happened before death because you must have blood pressure to have hemorrhage in the soft tissues.
And the cutaneous hemorrhage would be into the soft tissues, if you, as you define that term?
Yes.
Anything else about number 5?
Nothing else.
All right. I believe you said there was a number 6, or am
I mistaken? Number 6 has already been discussed. That is the wound to the right ear, which goes to the temporal bone.
Is there any other injury to the face that we have not discussed in 1 through 5?
No.
Is there any aspect of the addendum that addresses the last series of injuries, number 5, that we have not gone to yet?
No.
So as far as you're concerned, Doctor, have we completed a discussion of the facial injuries in G-55?
Yes.
Doctor, if you want to take the stand for just a brief moment and sit, I want to ask you some questions about some testimony. And I'm focusing now, Doctor, strictly on injury 5, this series of five superficial cuts, four of which you say overlay the confluent abrasion area that is injury number three. As part of your review, doctor, did you review Dr. Golden's preliminary hearing testimony concerning this area?
Yes, I did.
And inviting...
Well,
may I continue, Your Honor?
At this point, yes.
The
objection is premature at this time. The question was, did you review the testimony? Yes, I did. There's been no question that calls
for the harm is going to come if the question is read.
Now, that's a speaking objection as well. Proceed, Mr. Kelberg.
Thank you, Your Honor. Doctor, in inviting court and counsel's attention to pages 81 and 82 and 85 of that preliminary hearing transcript, and 86, I should say, was this part of the information you reviewed, doctor? Questioning by Mr. Hodgman. Now, doctor, I realize that there are more lesser wounds that were not indicated on your diagram, but I would like to move ahead now to the lower left-hand figure on People's 27 for identification. And, sir, you observed during the course of your autopsy five wounds to the right side of Mr. Goldman's face. Is that correct? Answer, yes. Question, and it appears that we have four of those five wounds marked in red on that lower left-hand figure on People's 27 for identification. Is that correct? Answer, yes. Question, now would you, in brief, describe those wounds for us, sir? Answer, okay. Referring to my notes, these were superficial cuts varying in orientation involving the skin of the right cheek, and they varied from approximately 1/2 to 1 inch in maximal length. Question, and these five wounds, sir, were not fatal, is that correct, in and of themselves? Answer, correction, yes, I said 1/2, it's okay. Referring to my protocol, they were small cuts. They varied from 1/4 inch in length to 5/8 of an inch in length. The superficial cuts on the right side of the cheek. Question, all to the right side of the cheek, is that correct? Answer, yes. And before I read the next question and answer, doctor, is this a reference to what you have described as injury number three, the area of the confluent abrasions?
Objection, you say.
Overruled.
You may answer.
I thought the cuts you described refer to injury number five, the five cuts.
May I approach, Your Honor?
You may.
Doctor, let me ask you to review, including the part that is going to come after what I've just read to you, and also invite your attention to page 85. I think I may have made a mistake. I may have misinterpreted.
Right.
But I want to be sure that the doctor.
All right. Mr. Kelberg, proceed.
All right. Doctor, in fact, are those the five cuts which you have identified collectively as injury number five?
Yes.
What I was reading. All right, then continuing on. Question, and were all of those antemortem wounds as far as you could determine? Answer, yes, they were. Doctor, are you in agreement with that opinion that those five are antemortem wounds?
Yes.
Now let me refer you to page 85 to questioning, starting on line 14. I'm sorry, let me start on line 7. Question, those are the five cutting wounds you testified to? Answer, yes. So it had two things visible there, the multiple abrasions on the cheek, and that refers to this injury number three, the confluent abrasions, doctor?
Yes.
And then the circumscribed area which contained the cutting wounds, the superficial cutting wounds. Question, and sir, with reference to diagram People's 28 for identification, you're indicating an area on that figure in the lower left-hand side, is that correct? Answer, yes. Question, now with regard to those abrasions, this is injury number three, would you characterize those abrasions as antemortem, perimortem, or postmortem? Answer, I would not characterize them as postmortem. They appeared to be perimortem based on their coloration. Question, and again, perimortem meaning, answer, at about the time of death, which could be shortly before, at the time of, or shortly thereafter. Again, doctor, you reviewed that testimony?
Yes, I did.
Doctor, do you agree with that opinion concerning that area of confluent abrasion?
No, I think it is antemortem because, as I pointed out earlier, the five, I mean, out of the five small stab, sharp force injuries we discussed, four of them overlie this area of abrasion. And these sharp force injuries show evidence of hemorrhage in the tissue, which would indicate that the person had blood pressure and the heart was beating when those sharp force injuries took place. So if they overlie an area of abrasion, the abrasion must have occurred before the sharp force injury, which would indicate that they also occurred before death when the person had blood pressure and the heart was beating.
And assuming hypothetically that Dr. Golden testified that in his opinion, the confluent abrasions which underlie the cuts were perimortem, that is around the time of death, would it make any medical sense to you how the cuts that are overlaying those abrasions could have been antemortem?
I said that they are antemortem.
No, my question is, given Dr. Golden's opinion that the underlying abrasions are perimortem, that was his opinion according to this hypothetical transcript, correct?
Yes.
Does it make any medical sense how the injury, which in your opinion comes after the cuts overlaying the abrasions, how they could be antemortem with the underlying injury, the abrasions, being perimortem?
That is what I opined already, the abrasion.
Basis?
Sustained.
Doctor, if Dr. Golden testified that injury number three, the abrasions, were perimortem, and he also opined that the cuts, injury number five, were antemortem, in your opinion, would that indicate that the cuts came before the abrasions?
No, the cuts came after the abrasion.
No, I understand what your opinion is, doctor. My question is, if Dr. Golden had the opinion that the abrasions were perimortem and the cuts were antemortem, would that indicate that, at least in Dr. Golden's view, the cuts came before the abrasions?
That is correct.
And doctor, if the cuts came before the abrasions, how, if you can explain medically, could the cuts be overlaying the abrasions rather than the abrasions overlaying the cuts?
It cannot be explained.
Would you consider that opinion, if held by Dr. Golden, that the cuts came before the abrasions, to be a mistake?
Well, he said it's perimortem, and perimortem also includes injuries which could just occur at around the time of death. But in this situation, I would consider it a mistake.
Any significance to you?
No.
Same reasons?
Yes.
Now, doctor, I think we're done with the picture of the facial injuries, and let's go, if we could, to the board that I had marked just before we started for the afternoon session, or for the just before the morning session ended.
362.
Thank you, Your Honor. Yes, doctor. Again, with the court's permission, would you step to this board of photographs? And this board is titled sharp force injuries to the left flank, left thigh, and right chest of Mr. Goldman, blunt force trauma, and lividity. First of all, doctor, we have a photograph in the center at the top, underneath of which there is a designation 43E. I ask you to assume that that is a copy of the same photograph, which is marked already as People's Exhibit 43E. And it reflects the condition of Mr. Goldman's body at the time the body was discovered by Officer Risky around 12:13 in the morning on June 13, 1994.
Objection, no foundation to that statement.
Well, well.
Doctor, first of all, inviting your attention to G1 and G2, are you familiar with what is shown in those two photographs?
Yes, those are the photographs of Mr. Goldman taken at the coroner's office on June 14, 1994. In the morning with his clothing present.
And doctor, does this, each of these photographs represent what you saw on June 13th, the day before, when you viewed Mr. Goldman's body and Ms. Nicole Brown Simpson's body at the time they arrived at the coroner's office?
Yes.
Now, Doctor, let me invite your attention, if I could please, first to a photograph in the lower left-hand corner of the chart or series of photos, marked G17. Are you familiar with what is shown in that?
Yes.
What is that?
That is a close-up photograph of the left thigh area of Mr. Goldman after his clothing has been removed. And this is the photograph taken after the body is washed. And what you see here is a stab wound to the left thigh. And it's a gaping wound. It's got a blunt end on its posterior aspect or on the right side of the photograph. And the sharp end on the left side of the photograph. And this wound is an antemortem penetrating stab wound, and it was about 3 inches deep.
Doctor, from your description of a posterior blunt end and using the left side of the photograph, the sharp end being on the left side, is that accurate?
Yes.
Do you have an opinion as to the type or class of knife or knives which could have caused that stab wound?
It's a single-edge knife.
Is this a wound which could only have been caused by a single-edge knife?
Yes.
And going back, if you can recall, to our chart with three different examples of wound patterns, which wound pattern, if any, would this particular wound reflect?
This would reflect injury pattern one, but I must emphasize that there is also a cutting component to this stab wound. That is, the blunt end is still retained, but the single-edge knife which caused this wound also caused a cut extension of the wound.
Doctor, in your opinion, is this wound a fatal wound?
It's a non-fatal wound.
What, if any, reaction from the body would you expect given the location of that stab wound?
It would cause significant bleeding.
Doctor, I want to invite your attention. And by the way, which leg is this, Doctor?
The left thigh.
Can you point out in your own body, on your own body, a general area location?
Roughly in this area here.
Could you pull your coat pocket back?
Right here.
Your Honor, for the record, the witness is identifying an area that is just to the front of his left pant pocket and down near the bottom of where the pant pocket ends.
Yes, upper thigh.
And thank you, Your Honor.
When I measured it in my 1:1 photographs, it measured G17. 1 7/8 inch by 7/8 inch in the gaping state.
Doctor, is that hypothetical single-edge knife with an approximate 6-inch long blade tapering at the tip consistent with having caused this stab wound?
Yes.
I want to invite your attention back to G1 and G2, and in particular, your attention to the left pant leg as shown in each of those photographs. Is the appearance of the pant leg in each of those photographs of some significance to you in evaluating the relative positions of Mr. Goldman and the perpetrator at the time that wound was inflicted?
Yes.
How so?
Because what we have here in G1 and G2 is extensive blood staining of the left part of the jeans which Mr. Goldman is wearing, which would indicate that he was most likely upright for some time after this injury was inflicted. Because as you know, blood which would come out of a wound of such as we have here in the left thigh would drain down the thigh due to gravity if somebody is upright, and that would stain the trouser or the jeans.
For example, Doctor, if Mr. Goldman had been in the position as shown in these photos, G1 and G2, and had remained in that position with the stab wound received in that position, would you have any scientific explanation as to how the blood could be on the pant leg below the area of the wound going towards the shoe?
It won't fit that kind of position because the blood seems to be definitely going downwards as though he was upright in the line of gravity.
Doctor, how rapidly a response of external bleeding would you expect from a from a wound the nature of this particular stab wound as seen in G17?
You would have significant bleeding from that stab wound, even though it did not injure any major big vessel. There are a lot of smaller vessels which supply these muscles in the front of the thigh, and it was a wound which went up to 3 to 3.5 inches in depth, and you have a pretty gaping wound. So there would be significant bleeding from that wound, but it's not a fatal wound because no major vessel was struck.
Doctor, is there a description provided by Dr. Golden in his protocol regarding this stab wound?
Yes.
Does the description include a description internally of the pathway of this stab wound?
Yes.
What is that description?
Basically, it goes through the muscular tissues of the left thigh. It did not strike any major vessel, and it was 3 to 3.5 inches deep, going in the left to right direction without deviation.
Given that description, are you able to offer an opinion as to the relative positions? You've indicated Mr. Goldman was upright in your judgment when he received this injury and for some period thereafter. Are you able to offer an opinion for the relative positions of the perpetrator and Mr. Goldman at the time that stab wound was inflicted?
I will not be able to give a specific scenario. The perpetrator could have been in the front or the back. If he was holding it in the right hand, the knife, it could be that the perpetrator was in the front. But I won't be able to say with definitive certainty where the perpetrator was or where the victim was when this wound was inflicted.
Doctor, if you'll keep your voice up, please. If we could find a ruler again. Would you show us what you mean with a right-handed person, that is a person holding the knife in the right hand, the relative positions, and then show us a left-handed person in the sense of holding the knife in the left hand. I will take on the role of Mr. Goldman. You tell me where you need me to be in relation to yourself.
Well, these are just hypothetical demonstrations.
You may continue, Doctor.
If you can be facing me in the front. One method could be with the knife being held in this manner, with the blunt edge on the outer aspect and the sharp edge on this aspect, like this, in the thigh.
And if you'll stop there very quickly, the doctor has taken the ruler to represent the knife in his right hand. He referred to the blunt edge as being the edge which is outer, the outer side of the knife, the sharp edge being the inner side, and he has pressed it against that same area of my left thigh, with the angulation being, is that the angulation, Doctor?
Yes.
He has the bottom of the ruler in contact with my body, slightly lower, perhaps at about a 30-degree angle from the horizontal.
Yes.
Obviously, then with the higher end, the other end being higher.
Just to add to the...
And if we could, can we turn in some fashion, Doctor, so the ladies and gentlemen of the jury can see what you just pointed to set the ruler?
Like this, yes. The other point I want to make is there is also a cutting component to the stab wound. So there was either movement of the knife or the victim's thigh during this time, during this penetration and withdrawal, which caused this stabbing plus a cutting component to it.
Now, what about a person holding the knife in his left hand?
Well, if it's in the left hand, you could have it the same manner, standing behind him and stabbing him in this manner.
And for the record, Dr. Lakshmanan has taken a position behind me and basically now holding the ruler in his left hand. Which would be the blunt edge?
The blunt edge would still be to the back. It has to be a single-edge knife for this wound.
And the blunt edge would be the inner edge in this scenario, Doctor?
The blunt edge would be facing me, and the sharp edge would be facing to the front.
And the angulation otherwise is still the same?
Yes. I just gave you two possibilities.
I think you need to angle around the other way to show the other jurors in the end of the box.
And is that the same angulation necessary, Doctor, under this scenario?
Yes.
Doctor, you indicated that Dr. Golden, addressed this in the protocol. Is that correct? This stab
wound? He addresses it in page 9 and 10, number 4.
And before we move everybody, does he also have some indication in a diagram?
Yes, he does on... Form 21, number 2.
Is it addressed in any fashion in the addendum?
No.
Is there any reason it should have been in your judgment?
No.
I can switch with Mr. Lynch.
And I'm sorry, the page number for the protocol, Doctor?
Page 9 and 10.
Number 4.
Page starts on page 9. Starts here as number 4, stab wound of left thigh.
Doctor, in your opinion, is this an accurate description of that thigh injury?
Yes.
And it continues on to the next page?
Yes. Top of the next page.
Before we flip it, let me mark. Is this the only injury, Doctor, of photograph G17?
Yes.
Let me just outline that then on our protocol, and I'll write G-17. And now if we can flip the page.
It ends here on page 10.
With an opinion?
Yes.
In your opinion, is Dr. Golden's opinion accurate on this particular injury?
Yes.
And I'll outline that on page 10 of the protocol, and again write G-17. Doctor, where in the diagram? We put up board 21, perhaps Mr. Lynch can refresh my memory as to the number of that board on the back. 3G, John.
Thank you.
This is 21-2. It's diagrammed in the right, left lateral view of the left lateral view diagram, in the left thigh.
Is there any written description which is attached to that?
Yes, it says stab wound to left thigh, 33 inches from the heel.
And there appears to be some writing, is there, Doctor, just above the SW?
Yes, it says length, and I can't read the letters. It says left to right.
And that reflects what, Doctor?
The direction.
Of the stab wound?
Yes.
So if I circle this entire area, Doctor, would this accurately identify what is G-17?
Yes.
And I've done so in blue and written the designation G-17. Is there anything further about that stab wound, Doctor?
No.
Anything further in the protocol on that stab wound?
No.
Anything further in the photograph of that?
No.
I want to move then, if we could, Doctor, to photograph G-10. Photograph lower right corner of exhibit 362. What are we seeing in that photograph, Doctor?
You're seeing evidence of three sharp force injuries to the right. First of all, we're seeing the right side of the trunk. Right side of the trunk from the right chest to the right hip area. And this is the upper part of the body. And the lower part of the photograph shows the upper hip area here. The right lower chest shows two sharp force injuries. Both are stab wounds, one located in the front of the side of the chest, which is toward the right side of the photograph. The other sharp force injury is to the left side of the photograph on the back side of the side of the chest. This stab wound, both of them are fatal stab wounds. They entered the lung and caused hemorrhage. We have another sharp force injury to the lower right flank area, and this one was a superficial wound. It was non-fatal. So this photograph, then in addition, we also have some abrasions, which appear postmortem on the side of the right chest, some between the two sharp force injuries of the right chest and the sharp force injury of the right flank, and an area of abrasion just below the stab wound in the posterior aspect of the side of the chest. I have numbered them for my convenience, and they have been addressed in the protocol and diagram, and we can discuss it in detail.
Doctor, with respect to these two fatal stab wounds, are those arbitrarily designated 1 and 2?
Yes, I numbered them 1, the one which is in the front, I called number one, and the one in the back I called as number two.
Let's start with number one. Can you point out exactly, using yourself, where that area is in the body?
Somewhere here in this region of the chest.
And perhaps you can turn so the jurors on the right side can also see.
Right here.
And, Your Honor, for the record, the doctor has pointed to an area below the nipple area, the right breast, and towards the back of the body along the midline of the side.
Yes.
And the second stab wound is in the, oh, you want to just do one by one?
Okay. Let's see if we can take care of one at a time. Doctor, are you able to tell from examining the photograph the type of knife or classes of knives, if it's more than one, which could have caused that particular fatal stab?
It was caused by a single-edge knife.
How are you able to say that that was caused by a single-edge knife?
Because you have a blunt end on the lower part and the sharp end on the upper part of the wound.
Would you point out for us which is the sharp end and which is the blunt end?
Sharp end is in the top here and the blunt end is the bottom here.
And for the record, the witness has pointed on the photograph to the top and bottom portions of the wound. Doctor, in your opinion, that stab wound could not have been caused by a double-edged knife?
That is correct.
Let me move briefly to number two and pardon me, and ask you the same series of questions. Are you able to determine from the appearance of that wound the type of class or classes of knives which could have caused that fatal wound?
That one was also caused by a single-edged knife. You have a blunt end in the back and a sharp end in the front.
Again, doctor, not by a double-edged knife?
That's correct.
Could the hypothetical approximately 6-inch long single-edged knife tapering at the point have caused both of those fatal stab wounds?
It's possible.
Doctor, are you able to determine from any description provided by Dr. Golden the relative positions of Mr. Goldman and the perpetrator at the time either of those two fatal stab wounds was inflicted?
It would, again, there are various possibilities for this, in which, various possibilities how this stab wound could have been sustained.
Let's start with the stab wound number one. What is the description? In fact, you said it is described. Let's find the actual description, if we could, in the protocol.
It's on page 8. Number one, the entire description applies to injury number one on G10.
I'll outline this entire area and write G-10, injury INJ number one. Doctor, can you summarize in lay terms for us the description provided here by Dr. Golden? Let me get out of the way so you can do something.
Basically, the stab wound entered the right chest in the area which I just showed you, went through a rib, the seventh rib, went through the lung, the right lung, and then came to strike the right fourth rib in its back backside.
I think maybe we need... All right, let's take 10 minutes.
Or beginning to describe in lay terms the substance of what Dr. Golden has described in this area of the protocol concerning that fatal stab wound number one. Would you pick up where you were, please?
The stab wound entered in the right side of the chest, went through the right seventh rib, went through the lung, the right lower part of the lung, and then the stab wound ended in the back of the right fourth rib. You have 12 ribs on each side, and the fourth rib, on the back of the fourth rib, the stab wound ended, and the stab wound traveled from back to front, right to left, causing injury to the lung, and that caused also bleeding. So this is a fatal stab wound. And the total length of the track from the skin to the back of the right fourth rib is about 4 inches.
That is how Dr. Golden has described this wound?
Yes.
In your knowledge of anatomy, is a wound path of approximately 4 inches consistent with the anatomy between the point of entry and where Dr. Golden describes the wound is ending?
Objection. Call specific question.
Oh, well.
You may answer the question, Doctor.
That would be a fair distance, which would fall within the parameters of the anatomy.
If you'll keep your voice up, please, Doctor. Let me underline, if I could, this last sentence of the third paragraph under item one, which gives the direction right to left and back to front with no other angulation measurable. Doctor, again, giving you the ruler, and I believe you indicated that there are alternatives depending on whether the knife is being held in the right hand or in the left hand with the thigh injury. Would the same apply with respect to injury number one?
Yes.
Assuming hypothetically that the perpetrator is holding this knife in the right hand, again using me as Mr. Goldman and yourself as the perpetrator, can you demonstrate for us how that wound could have been inflicted?
Yes, the perpetrator has to be in the back of Mr. Goldman, and the stab wound entry is in the front of the right side of the chest. As I told you earlier, the dull end of the knife is in the lower part, the sharp end of the knife is in the upper part. So if I'm holding the knife in this manner, with the it would be enter the chest in this manner, causing a fracture of the seventh rib, going into the chest cavity, and ending in the fourth rib. It's slightly vertically oriented also, so the blunt end is here and the sharp end is here, somewhat like this.
Doctor, if you'll fix that position so we can describe it for the record, you're holding with your right hand the ruler to represent the knife. You have positioned yourself behind me. You have the knife angled such that the part in contact with me is closer to the front of my body than the back end of the ruler, which is towards the back of my body, and the angle appears to be about a 30-degree angle from the horizontal, Doctor?
Yes.
May the record so reflect, Your Honor?
Yes.
Doctor, I want you to, if you could please, reposition yourself as you did for the demonstration when you described how the two superficial incised wounds had been inflicted, or at least in a fashion consistent with that. And may the record reflect the witness has done that, Your Honor?
Yes.
Doctor, in this position, could that fatal stab wound number one have been inflicted on Mr. Goldman?
After the hesitation cuts, or?
In this position where the perpetrator is holding Mr. Goldman in the fashion you are holding me?
Yes, it's possible.
And in what way, Doctor?
Because the location of the perpetrator is in a position where this kind of wound is possible, like the demonstration I did.
So in essence, does putting your arm, your left arm around my chest to restrain me affect in any way the ability of the right-handed perpetrator from behind to inflict that chest wound?
Yeah, the only thing is the victim's hand had to be a little bit on the, lifted for the wound to be in that area when the stab wound took place.
And is that something that can be forced by the right arm of the perpetrator?
Or the victim could be trying to move. As I told you, all these stab wounds and sharp force injuries are a dynamic process. It's not a stationary process where a wound takes place. So it's obvious that the arm must have been raised because the location of the wounds are to the right side of the right chest area, which if the arm is on the side here, it'll be difficult to do the stab wound, so the arm must have been raised at some point to cause these stab wounds in that region. So I really can't tell what exactly took place at that time, but the scenario we enacted is one possible scenario how this stab wound could have been inflicted.
Let's talk about if the knife is held in the left hand to see how that circumstance arises.
Then again, the blunt edge should be in the lower part and the sharp edge of the knife should be in the upper part, because that's how the wound configuration of the body surface is. So it would be something like this.
Indicating for the
but
record.
The only problem is it has to be a little more on the, it's going from the back to front direction. But if I'm in the front of you, it'll be more in a front to back direction. So the direction also should be more in a back to front, right to left direction, because that's the direction in the body. So the direction in the body doesn't change. So if you're going to enact a scenario, the scenario should match the path in the body.
And so the relative position, if you could retake that position, doctor, the relative position for the left-handed infliction of injury number one has my body turned at a diagonal with my right shoulder closest to you, and you then standing at this angle to me, so that your left hand is around the back portion of my body to inflict the stab wound. Is that
yes,
accurate?
Also your arm should be raised, because then only you'll have the, because there's no cuts to the arm, you see. So the arm has cannot be obstructing this entry of this wound in the right chest area. So that also is a factor which must be kept in mind. So when these wounds were inflicted, very likely that the hand of Mr. Goldwyn was not opposing his body. It was probably up, trying to wrestle away from the wound.
And doctor, if in your opinion Mr. Goldman had his right arm raised to wrestle away, would that suggest to you that the perpetrator is behind Mr. Goldman rather than in front of Mr. Goldman?
That could very well be a scenario.
Now doctor, as long as we had the ruler in your hand, let's see if we could get you back here for injury number two. Would the same scenarios that you just demonstrated for the ladies and gentlemen of the jury apply with respect to injury number two, the second fatal stab wound seen in photograph G10?
Yes, that stab wound is slightly diagonally oriented, just like the injury number one. And here the blunt end is in the back and the sharp end is in the front. You can clearly see it, the blunt end of the...
Let's see if we can get the pointer for you, doctor.
The dull end of the wound is on the back here, and the sharp end is in the front here, and it's diagonally oriented. So this also is caused by a single-edge knife, and this wound path direction is, I think, right to left, going... in a similar fashion as in injury number one, but more just in a right to left direction.
Doctor, is that wound also described in Dr. Golden's protocol?
Yes, it starts in page 8 and continues into page 9.
And while if we can hold up or flip over to page 9, there is a paragraph just above the opinion paragraph for that particular wound. Is that a description by Dr. Golden of the direction of the wound?
Yes, it goes straight right to left with no other angulation or deviation determined.
And also including a depth of penetration at a minimum?
Yes. The only issue here is he couldn't give more directions, because what you have here is a stab wound which enters a cavity and you don't have an end point to it. It went through the right lung. Unlike the injury number one, where the stab wound entered in the back of the right fourth rib, where you have a reference point where the stab wound ended, where you can be more definitive about the direction, all you can say here is it went from right to left because it entered a cavity.
Doctor, in your opinion, is there anything in the form of a mistake by Dr. Golden for his inability to provide a specific measurement for the depth of the wound?
It'll be difficult to give a... full depth of the wound, because the stab wound is entering a cavity. That's why he gave a minimum total depth of penetration, which is a correct thing to do in this situation.
And doctor, from your knowledge of anatomy, is that minimum depth of penetration consistent with the description of the injury provided by Dr. Golden?
Yes.
let me just outline this area first in blue that was talking about the direction. I'll also outline the entire part of page 9 of the protocol, right, G-10, INJ number 2. And let me finish off on the previous page. With the outline of the beginning description of G-10 INJ number 2. Now, Doctor,
again, can you, using the ruler, demonstrate first a right-handed perpetrator and then a left-handed perpetrator to create a direction such as described by Dr. Golden for stab wound number 2.
This particular stab wound, the blunt edge is in the back and the sharp edge of the knife is in the front, and it's obliquely oriented. So the stab wound is located somewhere here in the right side of the chest right here.
Let me turn just so the jurors can see that area where you're pointing, then I'll turn back.
Somewhere here, and all we could say was that it entered the chest cavity. It entered in an area of the chest wall which is called the eighth space, which is just below the eighth rib. It entered in that space, went through the right lung also, perforated the lung, that is, went through and through in the lung, causing bleeding. The direction given is just right to left. It didn't have an end point in the chest cavity.
Doctor, if you could hold that position one more time, is that the accurate direction using the ruler to reflect the knife itself that correlates with this wound description?
With the description given, this would reflect approximately what happened.
And, Your Honor, for the record, Dr. Lakshmanan, being behind me, is holding the knife, the ruler to represent the knife in his right hand. It has its end touching me. It appears to be slightly above the end opposite. Is that correct, Doctor?
Yes.
And it also has the back end closer to the back of my body than the end touching me.
Right. There's one more component to the wound. This wound, as you see, it's much larger. So just like the thigh wound, there has been movement of the body or the knife because there's a cutting component to this particular wound, either during penetration or during withdrawal of the knife, which would indicate either the subject mood or the knife mood. It doesn't have just it's got a larger appearing gaping wound, which would signify that there is a cutting component to the stabbing component.
Doctor, if we asked you again to reenact the position that you did several days ago regarding the superficial incised wounds and your left arm around my upper chest, and the one you just did for injury number 1. Would the same apply for injury number 2, that in that position of the perpetrator being behind and restraining Mr. Goldman with his left hand across Mr. Goldman's chest, that injury number 2 could have been inflicted with the knife held in the right hand?
That's a possibility.
Now let's see the alternative of a left hand knife holding situation.
It will be similar to what we just discussed earlier. The hand has to be elevated a little bit. And in this manner, which could be one possible scenario how this could have happened, with the knife being obliquely oriented to conform to the appearance of the wound on the body surface.
Your Honor, I cannot see that because of my raised right arm. Could the court help me out a bit?
Yes, Dr. Lakshmanan has the ruler in his left hand. He is pointing it towards the back of the chest area underneath your right arm, approximately 5 inches below your right armpit.
Thank you, Your Honor.
All right, I think you need to swing around to show the jurors
okay.
The angle.
This way?
This manner, if it's the left hand which is used.
Thank you, Doctor. Now, Doctor, with respect to these two fatal stab wounds, what would be the body's reaction to each of them?
Well, they are fatal wounds. They caused injury to the lung, and you have bleeding, and you also have compromising the ability to breathe. You're bleeding, and you also have compromising of the bleeding. breathing, because the blood accumulation in the chest cavity will compromise your breathing.
what kind of bleeding, volume-wise, would you expect from the individual wounds and then the combination of the two stab wounds?
You will have a significant amount of bleeding because the lung is very vascular structure. And actually, the total blood volume of the body can circulate in the lung in a minute's time. But generally, these wounds bleed, and you can have death. I mean, you can lose blood pressure rapidly if there's an accumulation of blood and air in the chest cavity. So